bring you grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We're continuing, as I mentioned, in the Psalms in the summer here. And as we are looking at today, we're looking at Psalm 121, as we just sang. And I'd like to just kind of do like by a show of hands, how many of you have gone on a road trip this summer? Anybody been on a road trip? Okay, you can put your hands down. One other show of hands. How many of you have been on a road trip with your family this summer? Yeah, that's always kind of a interesting road trip, isn't it? It's a lot of good times in the family with family, right? In the car with family. But sometimes the fun can also get a little bit aggravating at times, right? Sometimes when our kids were younger, we would hear things like, he's touching me, or she's over her side of the line, right? Which kind of wondered if you should bring masking tape and divide the van in half at some point, right? And before the advent of more modern technology, before the days of the in-car DVD players to entertain the kids and zonk them out, parents had to kind of come up with creative ways to keep their kids busy to pass the 10 hours of traveling, right? And so mom and dad made up things. How many of you remember the license plate game, right? Yeah, we're going through Wisconsin. How many license plates do we see? Three, you know? But keep looking, there's more out there, right? Or maybe you remember the alphabet game, like you gotta find a sign that starts with the right letter and then the next child's gotta do that. Those were cool ways to kind of keep the time passing while you're on a road trip. And of course, there's also other ways to pass the time when you're on a road trip. The inevitable road trip songs come out, right? I think a couple times we've taken the eighth graders on trips, we've had to ban 99 bottles of beer on the, you know, they're like, no, it's not appropriate, guys. But they come up with different songs to kind of pass the time, right? And maybe you have those songs that you like to sing as you go. One such family, the Griswolds, show us how song can be a great time to pass the time on vacations.
Hey, see that, kids? That's the St. Louis Arch, the gateway to the west. It's over 600 feet tall, and there's an elevator all the way to the top. That's 60 stories to you and me.
Wow, Dad, can we go up on it?
No.
Dad, what river is this?
Ah, that's the Mississippi, the mighty Mississippi. The old miss, the old man. Deep river, my home is over Jordan.
Beautiful.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly, fa la 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 la. Tis the season to be jolly, fa la 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 la. Don we now our gay apparel,
fa la 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 la.
Hey, did you tide carol, fa la 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 la. Take it, Russ. Fa la 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 la.
So sometimes road trip songs bring the family together. Sometimes they fall a little bit flat, like with Russ. But why am I talking about songs that we sing when we go on road trips? Well, because today we're looking at Psalm 121. And what's interesting about Psalm 121 is in your Bible, right before the first verse, there's a description of the psalm. And it says that Psalm 121 is a song of ascent. Or another way that could be interpreted is a song for the sojourner. In essence, a road trip song. And you wonder, well, why would God's people come up with like this psalm and call it a road trip song? Why would they need to travel anywhere and why would they sing this? Because, well, it's a song of ascent. They would sing it as they ascended on their way to worship in Jerusalem. Jerusalem built in the mountains and in the hills, and there in Mount Zion was the holy temple where God's presence was. And so as they ascended, they sang this song, not to just pass the time, but as a way of displaying and confessing their beliefs, of making claims about the God who loves them, the God who watches over them, the God who is their guardian, and the God who is their protector. And so they sang these songs as they went up those mountains, and they sang of the God who watched out for them. And so it became kind of a creedal, confessional song to make claims about the wonderful God that they were about to worship. Talk about a great pre-service song to pump them up for their real present God as they would travel to be in his house. And so the psalm begins with these words that we sang and that we heard and that we had in our opening liturgy. I lift my eyes to the mountains. Now, as they're ascending up this travel route, they physically are probably lifting their necks to look up to the mountains. But what's interesting in the Hebrew language is that when somebody says, I lift my eyes to something, it's a way for them to saying, I look at that thing with desire, not with dread. So, for example, no high school student ever says, I lift my eyes to finals week. No, they look at finals week with dread. They don't look to finals week with desire. But here, the people of God were looking to worship him with great desire as they lift their eyes. And they were proclaiming that we are going to a place where our God is present and where he promises to be there for us, and he will be there to help us. See, the mountains themselves were not all that important. The mountains were just creations of the Creator. But it was there up in the mountains, Mount Zion specifically, that the temple of God is where God had promised his presence. And they were excited to be going into the very presence of the Lord, knowing that as they came into his presence in that place, he was available for them to be their watcher and their help. As we hear that, we think about how as we come into this place, we too have a place where God's presence promises to be with us for our help. Now, somebody could quickly say, but Pastor Chad, the Bible says that God is everywhere, that he is omnipresent, so why does there have to be a special place? Let me answer that. You'd be completely correct to say that God is everywhere. His presence does fill the entire universe, but here's the difference. That presence of God, we could call his common presence. But it's here in this place, in God's house, where the good shepherd's voice is heard, where the sheep assemble, where we gather to hear his word, and where we receive his sacred gifts. It's here in this place that God's special presence comes for us, isn't it? Where he promises to give us help as we receive forgiveness of sins and as we receive purity from our transgressions. Where we have his presence, where Christ is here, and Christ offers us that help from sin and guilt and confusion in life. And so we too, like the people of old, can confess that we come into God's house to receive his special promise, because he's there to watch over us. That Hebrew word shamar means watchful. It's in the psalm 5 times if you look in your scriptures. But it can also be translated not only watchful, but it can be translated as guardian or protector. And so we have a God who is our guardian. He is our watchful protector. I was chewing on these words all week, trying to think of what comes to my mind when I think of a guardian, a watcher, a protector. I couldn't get this image out of my head. I apologize right now, but I'm going to show it to you.
In the eyes of a ranger, the unsuspecting stranger had better know the truth of wrong from right. 'Cause the eyes of the ranger are upon you. Any wrong you do, gonna see when you're in Texas, look behind you, 'cause that's where the ranger's gonna be.
Now tell me you wouldn't have a little peace in your life if you knew Chuck Norris was walking at your right side, right? That you had a Walker Texas Ranger right there for you at all times. Well, we have something even greater than that awesome show that used to be on. We have a God who is a watcher, a God who is a guardian, a protector. His jurisdiction and his authority far supersedes that of the Texan lawmen. And he promises to be at our right side as the one who is with us. And we are told that as our watchful God, he will not let our foot slip. Now, it's a beautiful image to not let your foot slip. When my children were younger, I would take them up bow hunting with me on my double stand. And we each had safety harnesses that we would clip in to keep us safe in case we would slip and fall. We were pretty safe. I mean, we'd be hanging there until Pam came out and hurt us, but Chad-like safe. But going up the ladder was kind of dangerous because you weren't harnessed in yet. And so what I would always do is have the kids climb in front of me, and I'd climb right behind them. And so it was like they were climbing by themselves, but I was kind of forming a cage around them. I wasn't going to let their foot slip. At the shortest instance of a slip, I was there to grab them. And I love that image of a God who doesn't let our feet slip because he is our firm foundation. Throughout Scripture, we see this idea that God is our firm foundation, that Christ is our solid rock, right? We sing it even in the more traditional hymns on Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground, that's sinking sand, right? Jesus is the one that we place our feet upon, and it's in him that we find a sure foundation. And I have one last piece of media I want to share with you, because over our national youth gathering adventures, there was an up-and-coming band that I got to see in concert twice, I Am They, and they have a song that's out right now. It's called My Feet Are on the Rock. And it just kind of illustrates this concept that as we stand on the firm foundation of Jesus, we have that certainty. So I want to share that with you. It runs about 3 minutes, and we'll conclude. Sure rock is Jesus Christ, our Savior. And he goes on to say that he neither sleeps nor slumber. One of those words means to nod off or to doze or to become groggy. And the other one means that deep sleep that we all wish we could get every night, right? But neither way, God does not nod off, and he doesn't fall asleep at the wheel of our life. Instead, he's watching over us. He's watching over us, it says, both day and night. He provides shade during the sun, during the day, right? We remember how he provided shade to the Israelites. We hear in other places of Scripture how that shade is the shadow of his wing, like he's bringing us under his care and protecting us from the scorching heat. He protects us from the moon. Not that the moon can sizzle us, but what it's saying there is he's watching over us both day and night at all times. Never is he sleeping and we're his second priority, but we're always part of his watchfulness. And probably the stanza that gives people the most troubles, perhaps, is where it says, the Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. You know, another way we could translate that is, the Lord will keep you from all evil. He will preserve your soul. Maybe that helps a little bit, but I know that there are times in our lives, times in people's lives, where they ask God that question when something tragic happens. Like, how does this verse make sense? God was to watch and keep us from all harm. And what does that mean, watching over our lives when reality doesn't always seem to match up with God's word? And there's times where we wrestle with that, and we might be honest with each other and say, that's some tough times in life where it is a faith issue where we struggle, right? But we don't quit trusting in our promises of our God during those difficult times. Instead, we hold stronger to him during those difficulties and troubles. Jesus himself says, in this world you will have trouble, but behold, I've overcome this world. And we're reminded that he cares for our temporal, earthly preservation and safety. And he also is very concerned about our eternal safety and salvation. And that's why God would send Jesus Christ as the promised Messiah that the people of the Old Testament were ascending to worship the promises of. Jesus, who came to defeat and to overcome the power of the evil one, and through the shadow of the cross, right? He's able to give us relief and healing from the scorching accusations of our sin. And through Jesus' death and resurrection, he becomes our solid rock. He's that place that we place our trust, that we stand in our faith. And so whether Whether we sing boldly the songs of I Am They, a newer band, or whether we sing boldly the song of ascent, Psalm 121, we can give thanks and praise to our watchful God who places us on his firm foundation. And so the next time you do go on a road trip, if you're thinking about getting one more in before the summer ends, I want you to, on that trip, think of your fellow worshipers of the Old Testament, and how they created these road trip songs, five of them to be specific, that were songs of ascent, not just to pass the time, but to describe the watchfulness of their God who brings them help, the God who guards them, the God who guards you, and the God who places your feet upon the rock. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for that blessing. We thank you for Jesus Christ, who is the rock. And we pray, Lord, that in our worship, we could place our trust in you as our watchful God. May we continue to place our trust in you, Lord, as you watch over us both day and night in our coming and our going out. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen.